Okay, Newt. The garage wall can't take any more abuse, Mom said, as she tucked her hair under the baseball cap. You and I are going to play catch. Just don't throw to me like I am some kind of rookie who is scared of the ball. I'm going to throw hard to you, and I expect you to throw as hard as you can to me. I have played catch before. You won't hurt me. I agreed because she's my mom. You always do what your mom says. It's a law. Look it up. We started throwing to each other. Mom was really good. Her throws were hard and had almost no arc as they smacked into my official Nelson Fox fielder's glove. She had the same expression on her face for every throw. Teeth bared. Eyes open wide and blazing, and her entire arm and shoulder committed to the throw. A look of sheer determination that said she could give me all I could handle and then some. The only way to deal with such intimidating throwing was to respond in kind. It was time to Sandy Koufax her. During the summers of my youth, our backyard was transformed from a lush grassy expanse into a baseball field for the Jones boys and other neighborhood kids who aspired to grow up and play left field for the Chicago Cubs. There was no home plate, only the bare spot in front of the crabapple tree next to one of the flower beds. First base was usually an old, unused baseball glove, a frisbee, or the arm of a lawn chair. Second base was the cushion that belonged to the first base lawn chair. And third base was the water meter cover. Of course, the edge of the driveway was the left field line. There was no discernible right field line. But if a batted ball struck the first base chair, it was considered fair just to make life interesting. Left field was the always scenic asphalt surface of Ash Lane, and right field consisted of the McPherson's driveway. If you hit any car in the McPherson's driveway, you were automatically out. Home runs had to carry on the fly into the Crears yard. Or into the McPherson's front yard. It was the greatest wiffle ball park in Major League wiffle ball history. Mom enjoyed having all this semi-pro sports activity in her backyard, but she hated the toll our running and sliding took on her yard, not to mention on our blue jeans. On occasion, she would sneak out to the field during our away games, rake up the soil on the bare spots, and put new grass seed out in a vain attempt to grass over first, second, third, and home. These efforts were doomed to fail for several reasons. First, it was the middle of the season with divisional playoffs nearby. The field would be heavily used, and grass seed had no chance under the repeated crushing of 30 pairs of PF flyers. Second, Mom's idea of protection for the newly seeded areas consisted of miniature fences, all of 6 inches high, made with little tiny pieces of wood with kite string tied to them. While Mom considered this to be a formidable barrier to the thundering wiffle ball herd, we, as semi-pro players, knew the only human being deterred by these structures was the mailman. The kite string fences would be gone in a cloud of dust with the first attempt to slide under a tag at second base. With the coming of the Little League years, it was time to get serious and put away childish things. It was time for hardball. It was time to prepare for my calling as the new left fielder for the Cubbies. When I woke up each morning, I wanted to play catch all day until it was too dark to see anything outside. I played catch with my dad until his bursitis kicked in and his arm and shoulder eventually gave out. This left me no alternative but to bounce the baseball off the brick wall of our garage for hours on end. After I had moved the garage several inches closer to the street with this activity, Mom stepped up to the challenge and strode bravely into the backyard to face the I want to play catch monster. That's when I accepted her challenge, held nothing back, and decided to bring the heat. I completed my windup. I brought my arm over the top, releasing one of my best throws, hoping it would curve, but knowing it wouldn't. At that same instant, the kitchen phone started ringing. Mom looked away for a moment, hoping someone would answer the phone. It was a moment that would live in baseball infamy. By this time, my throw was on its way at a velocity approaching the speed of light. It was headed towards Mom's head. Mom, look out! Mom looked back for the throw, but it was too late. The baseball caught her, thanks for asking. The baseball caught her square in the nose. She dropped her glove, covered her face, and crumpled to her knees. I ran to check on her, apologized for my throw, and asked if she was okay. I could see red stuff on her fingers. Mom got up, ran into the kitchen, and stood over the sink, blood running everywhere. Dad heard the commotion and came to Mom's aid at the sink. I think your nose is broken. Why do you think so? Because it looks like an S. Dad rushed Mom to the hospital. My brothers and I were left in the care of the McPhersons, who were told that I had attempted to kill my mother. At any moment, the police would arrive and draw a chalk outline of my mom's body on the spot where I had beamed her. I would have to leave home and fend for myself. I knew any employment application would sniff out my shameful act. Criminal history. Please indicate whether you have ever committed a crime, especially if it involved physical harm or death to your mother. After what seemed like an eternity, but was really only 3 hours, Dad brought Mom home. By some miracle of modern medicine, she would survive the injuries. Her face was heavily bandaged and braced with this large triangular contraption that straightened the S out of her nose. I was grateful and relieved she would be okay and would continue to raise my brothers after I ran away from home. Mom gave me a hug and told me she loved me. She hugged me and loved me for the rest of her life. We played catch frequently after that incident, and I went on to a stellar Little League career, although I was not destined to become the new left fielder for the Cubs. There was one thing I never told Mom about that fateful day. I thought it was best she not know. The official scorer gave her an error.